prison, cry out to heaven, shout until the door swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. Well, I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise, in the highest praise. Give him praise, give him praise, in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give him praise, give him praise, in the highest praise. Give him praise, give him praise, in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I'll praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day.
Whether you've been a part of our CPC family for years or joining us for the first time, welcome home!
As everyone is finding seats and getting settled, we'll be dimming the lights for our time of worship. So, if you have extra seats around you, let's help our ushers out by making room for those folks coming in.
We have so many exciting events and opportunities for spiritual growth that we can't wait to share with you.
Okay, before diving into what's ahead, let's do a little month in review of January. Did everyone enjoy that ministry fair?
Right? Wasn't that so good?
So good. Truthfully, I didn't realize there were that many ministries working behind the scenes to bring the vision to life for Sundays.
On the first Sunday of each month, we have on-site water baptism happening right here after our three services. Water baptism is an act of obedience of putting your trust in Him. It symbolizes that you are willing to follow Jesus and have your life match His will for you. You can take the next step in making your decision to follow Jesus public by either texting the word water to the number below or stop by the information center to sign up. You know, we've been having so many new faces here at Connect Point Church, Chris, and people are asking to know more about our church. Who or what direction should we be pointing them?
Well, the best way to learn the heart and vision of our church and get to know our pastors is at Connect Track every third and fourth Sunday of the month following our third service upstairs in the Junior 3D room. Lunch will also be provided, so be sure to register through the CPC app to hold your spot.
Monday is ladies' night, so if you're looking to get plugged in for a powerful time of worship, prayer, fellowship, and soaking in God's Word, we'd love to have you join us. You can find us in the sanctuary on Monday nights from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m.
And for you fellas, Tuesdays also at 6:30 p.m., Fearless Men Ministry gathers in the sanctuary for a time of worship, prayer, and diving deeper into God's Word. Fearless Men Ministry also hosts a prayer meeting to pray over the needs of our community the first Saturday of each month at 6:30 a.m. in Connect Kids.
Thursday, our Hula Ministry is having practices from 5 to 7 p.m. So if you're a covenant partner interested in Hula and want more information, please see Tony Wilmar.
On Fridays, Bold Youth grades 6 to 12 gather together at 6:30 p.m. right here in the sanctuary for a time of food, fellowship, fun, worship, and learning. See Pastor Cody or Muriel Pacheco for more information, or you can follow along with our updates on Instagram and our Facebook at Bold Youth CPC. Now I know we've all been waiting, anticipating, and I have finally got some exciting news to share.
Do share.
On Saturday, February 24th, we are inviting all of CPC to join us at the official groundbreaking ceremony for our Kalamana campus at 10 a.m. Registration is critical as space is limited.
So we have some save the dates for you. Home is having their second annual benefit fundraiser right here at CPC, March 9th, 5:30 to 8:30 p.m. This benefit fundraiser will help youth in foster care. Cost for this benefit is $30 per seat or $220 for a table of eight. If you would like to learn more about Home and their upcoming events, please see Wendy and Boulevard.
While we're still on the topic of save the day, you know, Karen, I have a hard time adjusting to change sometimes, but it's a crucial part of growth, right? Well, we're all about changing things up here at CPC. That's why we are changing location and changing service time for Easter Sunday. March 31st, we're having one big 10 a.m. Easter service at Sangha Hall. Invite your family and come early for those good seats.
Wait, one service?
Don't sound so shocked, Karen. You know we like to keep it fresh here at CPC.
I know this next one is way early, but there's a perk for early bird registration. Fearless Men Ministry is having their second annual All-In Men's Camp at La Pohoihoi Point, May 15th to the 18th, ages 13 and up. Please see Kimo Kohele or Terrence Rodero for more information, or you can sign up in the foyer. Stay with us, y'all. We're on the home stretch.
Hang on, we can't leave out Legacy.
Oh, we just can't. Legacy Bible Bookstore and Gifts is open Sundays before and after services and Wednesdays from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. They offer a variety of Bibles, pens, and notepads for all your journaling and devotional needs, clothing and adornments, a wide range of encouragement cards from our daily bread to special events for all ages, and so much more. You can keep up with their specials by following their pages on Instagram and our Facebook at Legacy Bible Bookstore. Now, Connect Cafes open on Sundays before and after services as well, and on Wednesdays from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. Their menu includes all kinds of drinks for both the caffeinated and uncaffeinated palates. You can follow their Instagram page for menu updates and holiday drink specials at Connect Cafe. That was a lot of announcements, but it's so good to see what God is doing right here within our Connect Point Church, Ohana.
If you need a recap on anything we just shared, you can visit our website at www.connectpointchurch.com or download our CPC app. You can also follow us on Facebook or Instagram for our monthly announcements. Well, that's all for now. Who's ready to worship?
All right, come on, church. Let's stand to our feet. Let's get ready to worship Him together. Let's give Him our best praise this morning.
Oh, I dread into the night and wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this bag of bones. Oh, and I tried with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that by what I see. I got no choice but to believe. My doubts, they are burning like ashes in the wind. Oh, and so long to my old friends. All my burning and bitterness, you can't just keep it moving. You're welcome here. And from now till I walk the streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back.
Hallelujah. Come on. Who's thankful that he loves us, has a plan for us? How many of you are thankful this morning? I want you to know, if you think your life is going bad, you've lost your thankfulness. I pray every morning you wake up with something to thank God for, because we are blessed people. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. If I'm not having a chance to meet you yet, my name is Dion, the senior pastor at Connect Point Church. I'm grateful for our team. Can we give it up for our whole big dream team? Pastor Ben, Pastor Ian, the whole team. We were gone for the last 2 weeks. We had our week-long conference. The Assemblies of God leaders gathered together, about 850 of us gathered there in Missouri, and hearing just what's happening, what's current in the church, what God is doing across the nation. I want you to know, God is moving. God is moving, not just here in Hawaii, but all across the nation. For those who are hungering and thirsting after righteousness, he's pouring out his spirit everywhere. We're grateful to be back with you. I want to share two quick spotlights, and then we'll open up the altars with our prayer team. Two spotlights coming up. The first one is, this Saturday is our groundbreaking for Kamana Campus. Come on. This has been a long time in the making. You see it as you walk in. 1,000. Our vision is 1,000 people, 2 years in 3 campuses. We've purchased Kamana Campus because of your generosity. Over $150,000 has come in for that campus. And we're going to now groundbreak. If you've been up there, things have started already. And we're trying to like hold the horse on the reins. It's like, all right, we got to go. Okay, so be a part of it. Come on up 10 o'clock on Saturday. I think there's about 75 or so that's already registered. We'll have our mayor there, our county council. About 8 or 10 other pastors from the city will be there. We're going to just pray over that property, those who will be working on it. That already the Lord is doing the work every day. Kimo, who's on staff, and he says about 30 people, horns will blow by. Beep, beep, beep. When is the church opening up? Come on, open the doors. We got to go to church. So we need to get that doors opened up because we know it will fill up there. So come be a part. Register. It'll be this Saturday at 10 o'clock right at Kamana, right off of Kamana Drive. If you're coming up, we ask you, would you park at Kamana Baptist Church, which is right on the corner? Mohu'uli, there's Hele Gas Station, Kamana Baptist. We got permission to park in their upper parking lot. There'll be shuttles shuttling people up there. We just don't want to bottleneck everything up there and make it a little unsafe. So if you'll help us park there, we'll shuttle you up there. Our last spotlight that we have for you is we're going to Israel. Anybody ready to go to Israel? Hallelujah. You might be here thinking, can we even go to Israel right now? Isn't it crazy? Isn't it dangerous? I tell you what, living for Jesus is dangerous. Walking by faith is dangerous. God's not called us to live a safe life. Faith is walking a very risky life. We talked to our leaders who are helping to lead the trip, and they said every year there is wars. And I said, you know, with everything going on, isn't less people going to Israel? And this was his response. People are sensing and feeling the signs of the time saying, Jesus' return is quick. We need to make our way back to Israel before we're up in glory already. So time is getting short. If you're interested at all in Israel, stop by the table, sign up. We'll be having a meeting shortly. In conjunction with that, I'll be leading a Connect group launching this week. Thursday at 6:30, we'll be meeting at the Kids Sign. For the next 5 weeks, there will be teachers from Israel who will be Zooming in live doing teachings about Israel, the state of Israel, what's happening, how we can pray, what God is doing to prepare our hearts. So if you have a love for Israel, want to know more about Israel, or going on the trip, join us for that Connect group right here Thursdays at 6:30. Amen. This time we'll have our prayer team come forward. Always say this, that the church is like a hospital, but that's not all that we are. The hospital is where people come and receive hope and healing and life, and you learn to belong to the family, and we train you up as the army of God and then send you out as the army. And I want you to know, just like heal a hospital, don't turn people away. Open 24/7. The church is here spiritually. And let's not pretend that we don't go through stuff, because we all go through stuff. I want you to know, if you need prayer at all in any way, God's called us here as the family of God to pray with you, agree with you, walk with you. So as we go back into some worship and praise into the Lord, would you come forward? You need prayer at all for anything or need to stand in agreement.
Raise it. Jesus, Jesus, your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome.
The name of Jesus over our lives, over our families, over our situations. Oh, hallelujah. The darkness that dispels when Jesus walks in the room. The praise of how we respond when Jesus walks into the room. When Jesus walks into the room, darkness flees. When Jesus walks into the room, shackles break. When Jesus walks into the room, addictions flee. When Jesus walks into the room, lives are restored. At the sound, at the name of Jesus. Even in the very beginning of time, when God uttered the word, let there be light. His very word is the name of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus Christ is the word in flesh that dwelt among us. Lord, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
Just take a moment, Jesus, to sit in what we're facing right now and to still acknowledge that you're over it all. No valley's too low, no mountain's too high, oh God, because your name covers a multitude of sins. We trust in you. If you're feeling heavy laden and burdened this morning, let the name of Jesus cancel the debt that you have. Break the bondage that you're in. Set the captives free. That's why Jesus came to this earth. He didn't come to set us free a little bit. He came to fully set us free and to give us a life that's not just a little, it's abundant and it's overflowing, because we got to reach everybody else. God, we're thankful for your presence, Lord. But we don't want to rush through the service without your presence encompassing us, Lord. It's in your presence the walls begin to break. It's in your presence where, like we sang, we find that you're the champion of our lives. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. As you speak to your people in this moment, Lord God, I pray that it wouldn't fall on empty soil. We just take a quiet moment in our hearts to reflect, sit in your presence for a moment. Get comfortable with quiet. Just allow him to speak to you. Greater than a sermon, greater than any word that anyone who takes the stage can say, the word of God is speaking at all times if we would just incline our ear to him. Speak to your people, God. We don't want to move too quick and miss a word that you may have. We linger. We linger. What would happen if we linger just a little bit more? Just a minute longer. What would you speak? What would you call us to? What would you prompt us in our hearts? God, we receive your word. The greatest word to ever speak or utter on the face of this earth. We embrace your will, your plan, God. You're touching lives. This is just the beginning. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. I pray that every time you come into the house of the Lord, I mean, His presence goes before you everywhere you go. You should be expecting everywhere you go. But something happens when multiple faiths are in the same place. Oh, I got plenty of faith I can carry for myself, but something happens when I rub shoulders with everybody else who I got. You give me a little more faith, I'll give you a little more faith. And together, oh, we're a machine moving and understanding that the grace of God covers us. And He's doing a mighty work here in this moment. Don't belittle these priceless moments in His presence. He prepares us to go out of these four walls and make a difference in this world. Well, as we shift in the remainder of our service, we look to our memorization scripture. How many are letting God's word sink deep in our hearts? Amen. We declared God's word last year. This year, we're still declaring God's word. But the only difference is we're trying to let it take root into our hearts and really let it sink in enough that we can have it memorized. Let it sink here in our minds so that it'll sink here in our hearts. That whether we hold this Bible in our hands or if it's far from us, we will not forget the Word of God. The Word of God will not depart from us because it's sunk right in here. So our scripture verse this month is Colossians chapter 3, coming from our Healthy Relationship series. And verses 12 to 14, let's just read this together as we memorize this and hopefully have time in your personal time to sit on this a little bit and chew it. Amen. Let's read this together. Since God chose you to be the holy people He loves, you must clothe yourself with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. Amen, amen. I need a little bit more love than I had yesterday for my family, for my friends, for my spouse, for everybody in this room. Come on. God's doing a work, amen. If you're happy to be in the house of the Lord, why don't you just greet your neighbor, give him a high five, give him a hug. There's just nothing like being in the presence of God. Thank you, worship team. Well, praise God. As you take your seats, we just get ready as to prepare for our tithes and Kingdom Builders offering. I want to let you know that, tithing is greater than your pocket. You know, we talk about this in our Connect track of how giving is a threefold area of our time, our talents, and our treasures. The very gifts that God has given you, you can steward before Him and give to Him. The very time, I don't know about you, but I got 24 hours in a day. How much do you get? You get 24 hours, right? You can steward that. And even your very wallet, your finances, what God's blessed you with in here in this moment. So however you choose to give, whether you give online, the drop boxes in the back, we always come back to this truth. We're making a difference in God's kingdom one seed at a time. And so if you choose to give today, if you go above and beyond the tithes, that goes towards Kingdom Builders, which really impacts our local missions, our global missions, and our future leaders. If you didn't know this, we support several missionaries that are doing work away from Hawaii. Isn't that crazy? That's the part. You have a part to play in that because you're planting seeds and Kingdom Builders, and we're able to take care of our missionaries who are out across overseas doing God's work that God's called them to do. And that's something to get excited about. So we're just going to cover this offering and these tithes and say, Lord Jesus, we thank You that You've given us the ability to give generously. Generosity is at the very heart of who You are and the character of who You are, Lord. So I pray we would reflect Your character by being generous in our time, our talents, our treasures, and everything that You've called us to steward. May we steward it wholeheartedly and without holding anything from You. Let's be obedient to what You're telling us to give and be faithful and steward in little. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Praise God. Well, we're going to get kind of right into the message today. And how many have been enjoying our Healthy Relationship series? Amen, amen. I'm so thankful that, you know, at the end of the day, I want to let you know that you need people. You need people in the confines of many and different people occupy different spaces and relationships in your life. But oh, how people is a catch-22 because sometimes you need them, but you don't want them. You love them sometimes, but sometimes you like slap them across the face. Let's be real. And this is why the subtitle to this message is Loving People God's Way. I got my own way I want to love people. You got your own way that you want to love people. But when I go to God's holy word, he has set me up for success. Now, it's up to me if I want to embrace God's way to love people or if I like to do it my way. And it's hard. It's hard. And so, like, the foundation, if I could sum the series up into one sentence, and I said this at the foundation of the message, part one, it really comes down to this. If we do not get the character of Christ right, we will always manage our relationships wrong. If I could sum up the series in one sentence, that'd be it, because we're talking about many different areas of relationships. But if I do not get the character of Christ right, I will always, emphasis on the always, manage any form of relationship here on this earth wrong. And it's because I need to understand, I shared the part one of the series, there's a book by Darius Daniels, and he says, it's called Represent Jesus. And he paints this picture that there's two ideas of Jesus. The Jesus that lives in our brain and the Jesus that walked in the Bible. There's a Jesus that we think, but there's the Jesus that we actually read about, right? Because there's a separation between sometimes, why is culture twisting the word of God? People do not understand the character of Christ right. Therefore, they're managing life in the wrong ways. So we come back to the great commandment, which is as simple as it is. Jesus, in his loving kindness and mercy, he summed up 613 laws into two. And I don't know, I got to take a praise break and say, thank you, Jesus, because my brain can't sustain 613 laws, but my brain can handle two. How about you? Love God, love people. Love God, love people. Jesus has a way to make things that we make so complicated so simple, even though it takes you the hardest to actually walk it out. And that's coming out of Mark chapter 12. And that's a great foundational, really, scripture for our mission here at Connect Point Church. We love God, we love people, and everything that we do really stems from that. So we got to love God, love people God's way. So with part one, I talked about friendship. I pray you have some good friends in your life. Maybe you got to take stock of your friendships lately, where you're at. Evaluate your friends. The Bible talks about that you'll know them by their fruits. That's people in general. You're going to know them by their fruits. So it's you inspect the fruit of the people that you're hanging out with. Last week, Pastor Ian preached a powerful word focusing on marriage. Stop trying. Start training. Hey, there's the idea of training. We got to get to the spiritual gym in our lives to train and not be passive. It's a progressive thing. And so this part we're focusing in on, I know preface at the beginning of the series, but we're going to talk about family today. Ooh, man, family. You know, the dichotomy here, and sermon notes are available on the app for you if you want to download the church app and click on media, click on sermon notes, the series is there. But the dichotomy between friends, marriage, and family, I'm gonna paint it out for you, right? I'm thankful. I get to choose the people I associate with. I get to choose my friends. Ooh, I'm thankful. I got to choose my spouse. Some countries, they choose your spouse for you. I'm thankful. I got to choose my spouse. But I want to let you know today, you ain't gonna get to choose your family. God has put your family and orchestrated your family in a way that sometimes, how many know, like, I love my family, both sides of my family, but sometimes we navigate through hardship. It's not easy sometimes. And I'm thankful, but that's the dichotomy here that I realize that there's a challenge in this message. And I want to let you know, this is the first time, fun fact of this message, the first time I went through three different outlines before I landed on this. But because God was just like, nah, that's not the one, that's not the one. And I really feel like the Lord wants to heal some of our families today. My plan was gonna be a happy message, practical message about parenting and you know, and being good fathers and mothers and stewarding children and talk a lot about that and also in extended families as well. But the Lord took it in a different direction, and I believe it's for a purpose. And so as we kind of talk about this, I understand that even when I use the terms throughout this message, like father, mother, husband, wife, daughter, son, brother, sister, cousin, auntie, uncle, grandpa, grandma. Even just as I spoke some of those words, emotions begin to flood your heart.
based off of just when I say Father. And I have to understand that this is a very sensitive subject to speak to. And I'm like, I come with a humble heart to say, Lord Jesus, help me articulate and communicate. Because what we need to understand is in this room right now, online, where you're sitting and watching this, is a very dynamic and diverse family unit. And I want to paint this picture to you to understand that you can grow up in a Christian home and still face dysfunction. We all have faced dysfunction in our own way. Some of us have been raised in brokenness and broken homes and broken families. And God, he desires to show you what real family looks like. And that's why I'm thankful for the body of Christ. That even if you grew up in a broken family, you're here today that you can rub shoulders with the right family to point you, to redeem what you've been through in life. God's a redeemer. He's a restorer. He's a refresher. He's a reviver. He's the God of re, because he just redeemed. He's the God of re. I wasn't in my notes, guys. That wasn't in my notes. Anyways, we gotta get cooking in the crock pot today. So as I was kind of sitting on this message, I realized that, like, where do you begin with this? Because I understand what this truth is. All so many different families in the room that are facing so many different things, past, present, future of what you're about to face in the future. But here's where we're going to start, and this is the institution of the family in Genesis chapter 1. We got to understand that God actually had an intended desire and purpose for the family in our lives. Here on this earth, he had a plan. Genesis chapter 1, verses 21 to 28 says, so God created mankind in his own image. Someone say his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. Let's just say that one more time. Male and female. He created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. And all the married people say, hey, hallelujah. Hey, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish and the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. This, it's easy to blow past the scripture, but this in essence is the very purpose that God is putting on earth. Marriage, family is twofold. A marriage between a woman and a man. And what is he saying here? To increase in number with children. Children, a man and woman and children. And I love this picture because there's a purpose for your family. And if you didn't know it here today, I want to let you know there's a purpose for your family. And it's multifaceted, but I want to come back to the very foundation of Genesis chapter 1. God created male and female in his image to spread his image throughout the earth. You are made in his image so you can be an image bearer. Ooh, come on. All I am is just a mirror. You watch me, and I'm just reflecting Christ everywhere I go. But you see, what happened is sin entered the world, which made it very challenging. How much more so do we need to reflect the image of God? This was God's design even before sin entered the world, that we would spread his image all across the earth. So how much more, now that sin has entered the world, should we reflect the image of God? Can I tell you today, culture has distorted the image of family. It has distorted and corrupted, and this culture is attacking our children. And we have to stand up as a church to understand, what did God call the family to? A marriage between a husband and a wife, and children who serve their parents and love their parents, and parents who love their children, to raise them up in the ways of the Lord, so that when I pass away, my daughter and my future children can spread the image of God, even if I'm not on this earth. That's God's desire for us. But the problem is sin entered the world. And I want you to think about this. Before the fall, even though it was just Adam and Eve on the earth, we were in perfect relationship with God and with people. Before the fall, before sin came into the world, Adam and Eve was in perfect relationship with God and with each other. But the fallen man, what was perfect, became broken. And I want to preface this message to understand this truth, because this is why I tell you, whether you were raised in a great Christian home, your family is still broken. Your family is still dysfunctional. Why? Because sin is still on this earth. And so I come to you today from a message to remind you, and from this title, Habits of a Healing Home. And I want you to emphasize the word healing, because of sin is still on this earth, we may never be fully healed. Through Jesus Christ, we found complete healing. But we're still prone to sin every single day. You understand what I'm saying? Healing is a process. So I want to talk about today, habits of a healing home. This is a biblical blueprint for inviting healing into our home. Three daily habits. And I say it's daily because it's going to take you every day to focus on these three areas that I believe will change, radically change your life, like I believe any message that we preach from this pulpit. Why? Because I'm preaching the word of God. Amen? So number one is this. We got to attack the power of sin, not each other. I'm telling you, if I've experienced anything growing up as the youngest of four boys, it's easy to attack each other. It's easy to want to attack my parents. And even now, I have my own family, I have my own frustrations, I have my own emotions on both sides of what God has blessed me with, but sometimes my perception doesn't look that way. What God perceives as a blessing, I'm like, you're bringing some problems in my life. But it's a daily choice to choose to stay, to choose to love, to choose to extend grace, to choose to forgive. You get a choice every single day. Are you going to attack the power of sin, or are you going to attack each other? Paul unpacks here in Ephesians chapter 6. He says this in verse 12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. But why does it feel like that's all we wrestle against? He's saying this. But against principalities, against powers, against the rules of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. I'm telling you this. Paul found it important to let every people know. He was speaking to the church of Ephesus when he's writing this letter. But he might as well be speaking directly to us, because the fight isn't with you. It's not with your family, not your brothers, not your sisters, not your parents, not your children, not your grandma, not your aunties. The fight is in the spiritual realm. We don't wage war in the natural, but sometimes our humanity and what the devil would like to do is distort the war to get you to focus on fighting your family over fighting the sin. And I love this. And it's interesting. I don't think it's any coincidence. Paul, in chapter 6 of Ephesians, you know what the first couple of verses talk about? He talks about family. He talks about children and following their parents and obeying their parents. And he talks about fathers not provoking their children to anger. And I just love the fact that the way he starts the chapter, he ends in spiritual warfare, that you got to put the full armor of God. And ain't that a telltale sign that I got to be putting my armor on every day when I face my family? Because I know I want to use my armor to strike them, not to strike the enemy. We got one enemy. It's the devil who roars around like a roaring lion to try to shift your focus from sin to family. Because God created the family as the foundation of all human life and society. Satan understands it. He knows this was the foundation for what God created from the very beginning in Genesis chapter 1. So he knows that he's going to throw everything at your family. When you're facing opposition, I want to let you know today, it is just an indicator that you may be walking in the right direction, that you may be pursuing the right purpose for your life, because the devil ain't happy, and the devil knows it. So when I know my family's going through hell, I know that God has something better, because the devil ain't happy about it. If life is breezy, beautiful cover girl, you better check yourself. Come on. See, there's a direct firepower that is directed towards breaking the relationships between spouses, parents, children, brothers and sisters. Church, the family's under attack in 2024. And this has been true since the fall of man. I want to go back here to Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 to 5. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals, is what it says the Lord God had made. This is Satan in animal skin here. One day he asked the woman, did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the tree in the garden? Before, I just want to take a pause break right there. I want to let you know the first thing that we see Satan do is cast doubt on the word of God. Did God really say that you would die? And I want to let you know today that sin is death. Sin is death. They didn't have an understanding to know that when he says you'll die, it wasn't a physical death, but it was a spiritual death. That because of Adam and Eve, we would now face sin for the rest of our lives. But then God created a plan to send Jesus Christ to the earth. The redemptive work of Jesus Christ is the only way to cover sin. I continue here. Verse number 2 in chapter 3. Of course, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, the woman replied. It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. How many know? Are you humanity? Do not touch this. Everybody like touch.
Verse 4, you won't die, the serpent replied to the woman. God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. You know what's crazy to me? They were already like God. They were made in the image of God. So isn't how conniving and sneaky the devil is to use God's word against him to say to the people that, oh, you'll be like God. We were already like God. And so there's deception that he's planting this doubt on God's word, and he's doing the same thing in our culture today. So I want to talk about really three characteristics that we have inherited from sin in the fall of the first family that we still face in our families today and we face as individuals. This message, even though I'm speaking to families today, it applies to really any relationship that you want to put in. And so the first thing that we see, the first thing that response that we see from Adam and Eve when sin entered the world, number one, shame. That's the very first thing when you read your Bible that you see shame enter the world. Genesis chapter 3, verses 6 to 7. The woman was convinced, devil convinced her. She saw that the tree was beautiful and the fruit looked delicious, so she wanted the wisdom it gave her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. Can we just take another pause break there? I want to let you know, if you're here in the room as a man, you're like, it's all your fault, women. I put the blame on you. Let's look at the text for a moment. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. I tell you this, if this doesn't communicate that silence will kill your marriage, silence will kill your family, silence will kill your relationships, because Adam was there all along and he said, nada. He didn't speak up. He didn't speak up for Eve. He didn't speak up for his future family. And at verse 7 says, at the moment their eyes were open and they suddenly felt shame that they were naked. That whole time they had seen each other naked, but their eyes had not experienced what sin had then covered with shame. So they sewed fig leaves together and covered themselves. And what's interesting about this is we realize that when sin enters our life, we always want to cover it up. We want to cover ourselves, but I want to let you know today, you can't cover yourself. You can't cover the sin that you face. You can't cover the shame that you're feeling right now. Some of you have feeling shame from broken relationships years after years, and you're trying to do it in your own strength. The only way you cover your shame is through Jesus Christ, the blood of the cross. And we see this in the home, right? I can't help but just bring attention to this in our culture. Instead of bearing the image of God, we have redefined what image looks like in the family today. And it's become a prideful thing, like, and we want sons so that the name can carry on, and becomes a very prideful thing. And I'm not saying if you're passing juniors in the second, the third, the fourth, I'm not saying that. What I'm coming back to is this thought of pride, that we need to understand that it's in our homes to say that, like, we have our own family image. But the reality of it is God said set the image from the very beginning of time. And we say, how many of you hear this? Hey, don't bring shame on your family. Don't bring shame on the family image. And oftentimes I realize that you want to do the right thing, but doing the right thing will bring shame on the family. Doing the right thing will bring shame on your entire. Hey, they say stay in your place. They say keep quiet. They say don't speak up. Shame keeps you in a hidden place, in a hidden state. There's shame, but shame pushed them to fear, and fear pushed them to hide. And they didn't speak up until God came to the garden and said, hey, what happened? Adam, where are you at? He knows where they're at. He knows what happened. He's pricking and prodding their heart. The culture that's consumed by sin has conditioned us to hide in fear and cover up shame that we feel. And I love chapter 3, verse 21. It said, and the Lord made clothing from animal skins for Adam and his wife. You know, I don't want you to miss this. God had to shed blood to cover their shame in that moment. He had to kill animals as a temporary covering before the redemptive work of Jesus could take place years later. A temporary covering before Jesus would come to this earth. Only blood can cover shame. Only blood of a man who was beaten, bruised, and thrown on a cross on Calvary. And his name was Jesus Christ. We sing about his name all day. All morning we sing about the name of Jesus. And I want to let you know that's the only name that takes care of shame in your life. Number two is blame. Genesis chapter 3 says, Who told you you were naked? The Lord asked. You have eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat. The man replied, it was the woman you gave me, who gave me the fruit, and I ate it. He's blaming two people all at once. He's like, it's the woman you gave me. Hey, I was fine with the monkeys before. But you done gave me a woman here. And you see the blame being passed on. And then what happens is we see in verse 13, then the Lord asked the woman, what have you done? The devil made me do it. The serpent deceived me, she replied. That's why I ate it. Blame is the result of sin. It's the result of the fall. And when we blame others, how many have seen this in your home? I remember growing up, and my first reaction wasn't to take ownership for something I did. My first reaction was to blame my brothers. Woo-hoo, God. I was like, oh, did I eat this candy bar? Oh, no. Chocolate over my face. No. No. Oh, I didn't. I'm like 4 years old. This is real. It really happened. Eating one candy bar. Like, psh, me? Did I eat my brother's candy bar? No. I'm guilty. But my deflection is our innate because sin has come into the world. And we see this with siblings blaming each other, false accusations, lying to save your own skin. I want to let you know that there's two unhealthy sides of blame. It's all my fault, which speaks of pride. I'm sorry, that speaks of insecurity. And then it's not my fault, which speaks of pride. Right? And both are very unhealthy. Next is fame. We see seeds of fame being planted from the very beginning of time when the family fell. And I'm not talking about just being famous. I'm talking about something that speaks to our need of recognition. Sin, when sin entered the world, there is this desire to be seen and to be noticed. In Genesis chapter 4, we're introduced to Adam and Eve's two sons. And we continue to see sin being passed from generation to generation. The ramifications because of what they did was passing, and it's still passing to this day. Genesis chapter 4, verses 2 to 5. This is the first two sons we see after Adam and Eve. When they grew up, Abel, one of the sons, became a shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground. When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best portions of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. I want you just to sit on this because I looked all over Scripture, and I could not find one family that I could use as an illustration for a happy, beautiful message. Because you know what I found? Every family in this Bible is so dysfunctional. And you know what that tells me? We all got dysfunction. We're all broken because of sin. And we see this with Cain and Abel. Cain, just to summarize, he ends up killing his brother because he just wanted recognition. He just wanted to be seen. Can I tell you, parents, can I just beware? Can I tell you just to beware of something? Beware of giving one thing to one child and withholding one thing from another child. But we need to understand what God is doing here. He was speaking to the heart. See, Cain had brought some of the things from his crop, but Abel had, his heart was invested. He's all in. We talk about New Testament giving. It's all about all in. It's more than just 10%. And so we see this. It's interesting how he rejected Cain's, and it pushed him to kill his brother. God is more concerned with the heart. Cain's heart was not in the right place. Abel's heart, he was giving fully of himself, but his anger, Cain's anger, led him to be the first murderer on earth. And we just see it. Well, I tell you, you just read your Bible from beginning to end. You just see some jacked up people. But it gives me assurance that God still uses jacked up people. Come on, somebody. God still uses sinners. God still uses people who've been through hell. God still uses them. Why? Because we live in a fallen world now because of Adam and Eve. But the answer is Jesus Christ. The answer is Jesus. We may spend more time attacking. I pray we would spend more time attacking the sin in our lives and stop attacking each other. We have to stop attacking each other. We have to answer to the shame, the blame, and the fame with the name of Jesus Christ, who covers a multitude of sins. We attack the power of sin, not each other. Secondly, if we want to see a healed home, a healing home, we accept the power of repentance. Accept the power. Repentance is a powerful thing. Repentance. To experience healing in our home, in your family, near and far, begins with embracing the power of repentance in its critical role in leading your life to wholeness and freedom. See, repentance, I believe, is the first step towards the ultimate goal of reconciliation. Now, I want to preface this and just share a caveat with this message, because what I can share in maybe 40 minutes may take years to unload. So I don't want to belittle what you're facing, what you're dealing with, because this, what I'm talking about today, is hard. It's hard. But here's what we need to understand here. Romans chapter 2, verses 3 to 4 says, "So when you, a merely human being, pass judgment on them, and yet do the same things," right? We're all guilty of it, "do you think you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, forbearance, and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance?" See, sometimes we're so quick to throw the blame somewhere else so the heat is taken off of us. And I want to paint this importance of repentance. It's both vertical and horizontal. I just love this picture, because when you do that, you create a cross. Through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, he aligns you to himself and to each other. Through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, he aligns you in relationship with God and in right relationship with people. But that's something we got to fight for every single day. And so vertical alignment communicates that I'm pursuing a right relationship with God. Horizontal alignment is pursuing a right relationship with others. See, I want to let you know today, repentance is bigger than just repenting before God. That's the first step. That's the first step of healing your life, healing your home, healing your family. But it also requires you to take a step towards healing on the horizontal with the people that you rub shoulders with every single day. It's the first step in the process, but it's not the only step. We have to do that step. So there's a couple things about repentance that I want to kind of unpack here. Number one is repentance commences with me. Repentance is able to begin when I let it start. It's right, we come back to that, the idea of choice. I have a choice to when I want to walk into repentance. Romans chapter 12, verses 18 says, "If possible, so as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." What does this communicate? He's saying, if possible, which means sometimes it's not possible. But you know what you can do? You can make sure you do everything in your power to make it right on your side, on your piece of the pie. I want to let you know, in a family, you all want big pie, and you all got a piece of the pie. So how can I be like, "Hey, not my responsibility. That was on you, bro. You're going to handle it yourself." Oh, I can look within myself and say, "Lord, how can I take responsibility for my piece of the pie? I'm in this family. I can't throw and blame and throw at everybody else. I got to look within myself and say, Lord, how could I have responded better?" Repentance commences with me. Secondly, repentance changes my mind. In the Bible, particularly in the New Testament, we talked about this even when we went through our Revelation, the church, Seven Churches series. The word repentance literally means a change of mind. It's when you decide that you got to change your mind. I love what Rob Renau says. Repentance means that we radically shift our thinking, attitude, and mindset about our sin. We take responsibility and drop the excuses. How many got excuses out there? I got plenty. We stop sugarcoating, minimizing, and blaming. Ooh, he done strike us to the heart right there. Repentance should change my mind, but it shouldn't even end with that. Repentance also should continue to transform my behavior. What good is it for me to have a changed mind, but I'm still heading in the horrible direction? I'm still heading in the wrong direction. What good is it for me to know the right thing to do? We talked about this part one of our series, what James says in chapter 4, verse 17. Sin for a person, or maybe this was in the series before, I'm sorry. But sin for a person is knowing the right thing to do and not doing it. That's sin for you. If you know what you should do, and in your mind you know what you need to do, but if your feet aren't following your heart and your mind, what the Lord's speaking to you, you're still walking in disobedience. And so repentance continues to transform my behavior. See, apologies, how many know? Apologies become real hollow when you keep repeating an offense in your home, in your relationships. When the same person keeps apologizing for the same things they keep doing over and over again, after a while, it's hard to even embrace a genuine apology. Why? because they know the right thing to do, and it's leading to a place to say, "Ah, I'm so sorry. But it hasn't changed their footing, hasn't changed their direction. I love what one author said about this, about repentance. He describes it this way. Imagine that you were out for a long hike in the woods. After walking for a while, you recognize that you have taken a wrong turn. Oh, how many have been in the woods before and you've done that before? Ooh, watch out. In the mainland, you can get lost real fast. You stop hiking, you stop hiking in the wrong direction, turn around, and hike back towards the point where you took the wrong turn. That seems pretty logical, right? That is repentance. First, you recognize that you have gone down the wrong path. Your mind changes. Second, you turn around and take intentional steps in the right direction. What does that communicate? My behavior has now aligned with my changed mind. That's the important thing that we need to come back to. It can't stop here. It needs to start here, overflow to here, to then take me and move me into motion. It's not a passive thing. It's a very active thing, repentance. We have to attack, viciously attack the enemy, not each other. The one thing that we want to do is go full throttle on our family and let them have it. But secondly here, there's this thought that the power of repentance, it opens the door to freedom in your life. But it is that first step. And I don't know where you stand here today with the Lord, but I truly believe that some of you have maybe taken the step of repentance, but haven't took that next step. Maybe you take the step of repentance vertically between God, and you seek in reconciliation between God, but you have yet to take that step to lead you to reconciliation with your family, with your relationships. This is not an easy message for me, but I truly believe that when we acknowledge the primary purpose of the gospel, when I go back to Genesis chapter 1 and I see God's innate model, his intended model before sin was to spread God's image, and his model remains the same even after sin entered the world. Was God aware? God has foreknowledge to know everything that's going to take place. But how he still loves his people and chooses to use a broken family for a redemptive work. And I'll tell you this, I know my family's broken, but God can still use my family. I know my life is broken, but God's still using me. And this gives me a peace and just a joy to understand that I'm a flawed human being, that I will never reach the standard of Christ, but every day I'm walking. Every day I'm making choices. Every day I'm loving my wife. I'm loving my kids. I'm loving them to the best of my ability. Every day I speak this over my life and my affirmations. I know I talk a lot about this. But I choose and I resolve in my heart that I want to live a life that shows my wife and my children how to live for Christ. And that's what God intended for the family. You are image bearers of the one who created you. You're image bearers. So I pray that all we need to do is pull out a mirror and reflect the right thing. Because sometimes we pull out a mirror, but we're not looking to God. We're looking to our family. We're looking to other families. We're comparing ourselves to other families. I want to tell you today, your greatest comparison is to mirror your life after the work of Jesus Christ. He came on this earth. He walked for 3 years. He didn't struggle. He didn't stumble. But he left us a perfect example. And I'm thankful for Jesus Christ and the work of repentance that he leads us to because of the cross. His kindness leads us to repentance. And God wants to do a healing work in your family today. I truly believe it. I truly believe it. We got to attack the power of sin, not each other. We accept the power of repentance. Lastly, we willingly choose. Somebody, you got to just say, willingly choose. I willingly choose to act in the power of forgiveness. When I was writing out this sermon, naturally my brain went to act out. I don't know. When I think about acting out, I don't think that's a good response. How about you? Sometimes, how many know, sometimes we act out irrationally. Sometimes I act out in my emotions. And I want to let you know, if there's one thing I've learned in 2023, it's that you got to have emotional intelligence to walk into every season of your life, because sometimes I want to act out, but you know what I got to do? I got to act in the power of forgiveness. I got to act in the power of the cross. I got to act in what God is trying to help me steward in this life. Because oftentimes my humanity, the sin inside of me, I like act out. It's so easy to act out. It takes no energy for me to act out. You know what it takes energy? To act in. To be submissive to. To be under authority. That's acting in the power that only comes through Jesus Christ. Ooh, that's an extra. Ooh, that's extra for second service today. Our ability to engage in the act of forgiveness within our home and family has the power to bring healing into our broken families through Jesus Christ. And I just want to say this. If you desire a greater peace, greater joy, greater love in your home, we must master the art of receiving and giving forgiveness. Ooh, it's an art. It's an art to master the craft of forgiveness. Every day I got to work on it. Every day I got to try my best because, Lord forbid, I act out in my sinful nature. And there's a difference between repentance and forgiveness. Maybe some of you are thinking like, isn't repentance and forgiveness the same thing? I want to unpack why it's not. Repentance is the act of admitting wrongdoing and saying sorry. That's that next step, right? So even this, the thought of communication. How many know, I want to talk a lot about communication today. Can I just tell you that? Because I want to let you know there's a lot of communication gaps in the family. Ooh. You know what I mean? I tell you, I say one thing, but my wife heard something else. I think something, but I didn't talk to my wife. That's called unsaid expectations. That's real. And I just want to let communication is the foundation up next to Jesus Christ for a good marriage, for a good family, for a good home. But I want to come back to this thought of repentance and forgiveness. And that's why I said, like, man, this message is all over the place. Lord, what are you trying to speak to your people today? And repentance is the act of admitting wrongdoing and saying sorry. What does that communicate? Confess. What is confession? Communication. It involves someone understanding how their actions have caused pain and suffering to one another. But here's the difference. Forgiveness is the courageous act of pardoning an offender. It takes great courage. It takes great courage to step into repentance as a first step and walk through that process vertically, horizontally, that hopefully it will lead you to a place of forgiveness. What is forgiveness? It is my ability to pardon the other person. Even if they didn't pardon me. Because I want to tell you today, forgiveness is more for you than it is for the other person. Because why? Why? I cannot control how you respond, but I control how I respond. I cannot control you. You know what? I know it's about family, but I also speak to the marriage for a moment. When I had a realization, and someone would say, praise Jesus, I had a realization in my own home, in my own marriage, that this thought of forgiveness, this thought of, right, it's so easy to throw at, you're the problem, there's the blame. If you would just fix her, if you would just do a work in her life, God. I'm trying to encourage her. I see the potential. I want to push her to that success, Lord. I had a realization I was doing it the wrong way. And there's this thought of forgiveness. And sometimes you got to forgive yourself before you can embrace how God has wired your spouse, how God has wired your children. Because be careful, parent, to project and throw things on your child that God did not intend them to embrace. And we see it all the time. A children who's maybe not good at sports, but because you are great at sports, you push them into sports. When they don't enjoy it, they don't love it. And I wanted to speak to this for a moment because I see it too much. That understand what God has given your children. Help to steward it, cultivate it, so that even God gave you gifts. And if that was to be a great athlete and you did great things in that, great. But God's doing a mighty work. And I don't know why, I just felt to speak that. But it's not just sports, it's anything. You were a valedictorian. And you're holding this high standard on your children that they got to reach the standard. All A's. And you're hard on your child. You want to make sure they do the right thing, and that's important. But I want to let you know, is that the most important thing? I believe that we need to forgive ourselves sometimes, and then God will allow us to forgive our home and our family and our children. It takes a courageous act to pardon yourself as much as it is to pardon others. In the Bible, the Greek word forgiveness is alpha and me. You just got to say it with confidence. Sometimes, I might say it wrong. Can I tell you, alpha me, alchemy. You look it up. If I said it wrong, you correct me later. Sometimes you just say it with confidence, with boldness, and pray that you locked it in. I didn't have time to look it up. I'll be real. Which is translated to mean to let go. Just let go. As a person does not demand payment for debt. So there's really three phases as we face this challenge of forgiveness. You know, can I tell you this? I just want to just preface this. The challenges in your family, it's not a surprise to God. Nothing surprises God. He knows all things that you're going to face, what you're going to face in your family. But he desires to use those struggles and those conflicts and those things that you are like, oh, Lord. He desires to use those things to draw you closer to him and help us experience the gift of forgiveness and reconciliation. I'm speaking to the choir. Don't make me feel alone up here. Three phases of forgiveness as I want to begin wrapping here. Phase number one is forgiveness with the will. Forgiveness with the will. If we are commanded to forgive, then forgiveness must involve a choice. Right? We talked about this, a choice. It begins with the act of the will. You got your own will because Adam and Eve had their own will. They chose to embrace sin instead of God's plan. But here we are. No longer are we going to throw blame. Can I just tell you this? Stop throwing blame at Adam and Eve. If you're that person, be like, oh, when I get to heaven, I'm talking to Adam and Eve. Oh, I'm running up there. I'm going to talk to Adam and Eve. Hey, I'm just glad I'm in heaven. Hey, I'm just saying, Adam and Eve, hey, we know we struggle together. That's all right. We all fall short. We all fall short. Love you. Anyways, so this idea of forgiveness in the will, it starts in your will. You forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. And you know, can I be real? There's these. Have you ever processed through things? Sometimes there's irrational that we do, and we convince ourselves out of what God wants us to do. And so you may have been pushed. You feel prompted by the Lord to pursue horizontal alignment with your family, to confront. And you may have said this, I don't feel ready to forgive him. I don't feel ready to forgive her. I want to let you know, you're never going to be ready. You ain't never going to be ready. But at least start the process. I'm not saying that reconciliation is going to come right away, but at least you're taking the right steps towards reconciliation. See, we have this wrong thinking when it comes to forgiveness that when I forgive, I just got to just let it all go right off the get. No, it's going to take time to navigate and walk through that. What I'm saying in a 45 or 50-minute sermon, it's going to take a long time to walk out practically in your life. What if they don't take responsibility for their bad behavior? If they don't take responsibility, that's not on you. You take responsibility for what you can take responsibility for. I cannot take responsibility for your actions, but I sure as can take responsibility for mine. They haven't apologized yet. They haven't asked for forgiveness. Well, even if they haven't asked for forgiveness, I could still extend forgiveness to them. You know what I've realized about unforgiveness is the thing is we're always the victim. But the truth of the matter is, like I said about the family, you always take a piece of the pie. I have added, even if I wasn't the first, maybe somebody hurt me, my response alone, usually my first response isn't, hey, Lord bless you. Hey, love you, brother. Usually my first response is like, oh, you like get at me, bro. Yo, let's go, dude. Hey, yo, you gonna slap me like that, bro? I'm gonna slap you right back, dude. Well, how many know in the family? It's real. It's so real. So even if they don't choose to forgive you, you can make the conscious decision every day to choose, I'm gonna extend forgiveness to you, even if you don't want to extend it for me. That's the first phase. It's forgiveness for the will. Second phase is phase two, forgiveness with the heart. We're talking a lot about this. Pastor Ian hit on this last week with marriage and to stop trying, start training, and how important it is that it starts here and it flows to here, and we got to steward both the mind and the heart, because if not, they're going to lead us into a dark place, and we need the blood of Jesus Christ to cover our minds and our hearts to help us respond in the proper way. Jesus calls us to forgive from the heart. And as we've discussed in this series, this heart really does shape us. The heart is God's territory. Oh, I'm glad that God knows a little bit about the heart. And God had such a good plan that he knew that he could put his word in human skin so he could walk the earth and that he could feel a little bit of what humanity feels like. You know who understands the heart the most? The one who created you. And so He's the only one who has the power to change your heart. But we must first let him occupy the spaces of it. Let him into our hearts to let him change us and transform us. You know, Jesus shares a powerful parable with his disciples. And he's really, Peter had prompted a question like, hey, you know, how much am I supposed to forgive somebody? You know, and I'm paraphrasing here. How many times we ask that question? Like, yo, how far is, where's the line, Lord? Where's the line? And God's just like, oh, you want to talk to me where the line is? You want to talk to me where the line? Let me show you where the line is. And he paints this powerful this parable, and I would like to call it 70 times living. And that's what he's saying. And he asks him, how much should I forgive my neighbor? He's like seven times. It's like, and so even back in that culture, seven times was more than generous to forgive. In fact, there was a lesser number of what you were required by law in that culture. So Peter's probably like, hey, that's pretty good, Lord. That's pretty good, right? And the Lord responds to him, no, actually, it's 70 times seven. I want you to catch the picture of what God requires us to extend in forgiveness. 70 times seven, that's a lot. What does that communicate to you and I? That every time, after every time, after every time, that we have a full heart invested to forgive, to willingly forgive, even if somebody else doesn't forgive me. And he talks about this parable leading into that. From that conversation, I'm thankful for the Bible. From that conversation, we get this parable. You don't get to read this anywhere else. Ooh, there's something special about this. And he says this in Matthew chapter 18. Just to give some preface before I read this in verse 32. This is really about a king and a servant. And the servant owes the king a ton of money. In fact, it's translated to like millions upon millions of dollars. This king is about to be made out because this servant's in a huge hole of debt. And so Jesus begins to paint this beautiful picture. And the servant comes to the king. The king calls him in and says, hey, bro, I don't know if you remember this, but again, I'm paraphrasing. I don't know if you noticed, though, you got a huge debt that you owe me, dude. He's like, oh, king, Lord, please. Please forgive me of this debt. I can't do this. He's like, hey, let's form a payment plan. Let's try to figure this out. He's like, oh, I can't do it. Please, I can't do it. I need my family. We only have a little bit. I need as much as I can to sustain my family. And the king felt compassion on the servant. And this is the parable that Jesus is communicating in thought of forgiveness. He then, therefore, he leaves that conversation, the servant, after being pardoned by the king. And he finds a fellow servant who owes him money. And the Bible says it's about $1,000, some couple thousand. Doesn't really specifically say. And so he's having this interaction. He's like, bro, you owe me money, dude. You better pay me back. You better pay me back my money. Hey, you know what? If you don't pay me back, I'm going to throw you in prison. And he throws this guy in prison because he ain't pay his money. But he forgot the king just pardoned the money that he owed the king. And so what is Jesus trying to say here? In verse 32, he says this in Matthew chapter 18. The story continues. The master called in the servant. You wicked servant, he said. I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had the mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. And when I read this, it's like, oh, you know, naturally we read this like, this guy, this servant, like, why would he do that? What a foolish guy. Like, and we begin to like throw him under the bus. But you know, it's just as ridiculous for us to withhold forgiveness from others when we understand what Jesus had pardoned us from on the cross. We owed a debt that you and I could not pay. Jesus was willing to pay the bill for you and I so that we could have freedom, that we could walk in freedom, that this thought of a healing home, it's actually possible through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ on the cross. So far be it from me that I would hold forgiveness from somebody else when God has forgiven me my debt. Think about a debt that you had. I have student loans. I can't stand my student loans. If somebody was to come at me today and say, I'm paying your student loans. Hey, I was going to be celebrating. I'd be throwing a party at my house. I would be celebrating with joy because that debt is mine to pay. And the same thing that Jesus is showing us through salvation, what he paid for you through salvation, we should be able to extend forgiveness to other people.
And the third phase is reconciliation. I invite the worship team to join me on the stage. The third phase leads us to reconciliation. It starts with forgiveness in the will, forgiveness in your heart. And I want to make sure you know this. Again, these phases could take years to walk through. But the goal is that you know and you can resolve in your heart between you and the Lord and say this statement: I know I have done everything in my power to make this right. And what does that communicate? I know that through the work of Jesus Christ, he's given me that vertical alignment, but I got to choose to repent and receive him. And I'm aware that I have done everything on my part. I've taken responsibility. I've repented. I've walked through it to align myself with my brother, with my father, with my sister, with my grandma, with my grandpa, with my auntie, with my uncle. That I know I'm in a right relationship with God because I have done my part. But maybe some of you can't answer that and say, I haven't done my part. I haven't done my part. This is the hard truth. The final phase of forgiveness is when a relationship is healed and reconciled. See, God can bring us to a place of complete forgiveness without the relationship being fully healed. And I know that, like, it kind of hurts. You're like, why is that? But at least I know that I've done my part. And that's what God requires of us. It may be that the family member who has hurt you never repents, never shows compassion, never takes responsibilities or changes their behavior. See, reconciliation, I want to be clear, it's not sweeping things under the rug. It's not pretending like they never happened. It's not justifying the abuse, tolerating the ongoing abuse. Let me tell you this, reconciliation is understanding what someone has done to me and still choosing to pardon them through the courage of forgiveness. The courageous act of forgiveness. So as I was reflecting and sitting in this message, and I was like, I know the Lord wanted to close this service in a very specific way. And I think we're going to even change it up a little differently, if that's okay, from the first service. And so if you're in this room today, we talk about these habits of a healthy home. It's nice. We talked about attacking the power of sin, not each other. Accept the power of repentance, act in the power of forgiveness. But I really believe that God wants to heal our homes. He wants to heal our families. But truth of the matter is, sometimes that decisions rest on our shoulders to be able to walk towards that healing. It's not passive. It's very active. So this is how we're going to end the service. If you're going through brokenness right now in your family, I want you to take a stand. Whether you have done some wrong to a person or they've done you wrong, I don't, either side of the bill, I want you to stand in this moment. If you're going through a broken relationship, any relationship, maybe there's several. If you could think of somebody right now in your family that you have a separated, broken relationship with, I want you to stand. It may not be everybody, and that's okay. But I want to speak directly to you who you're going through familiar brokenness right now. We're going to take this first step. And if you're not ready, you don't got to stand. There's no pressure in this moment. But I want to encourage you that if there's something that you're going through right now and you're this brokenness in your family, the first step is to vertically align yourself through repentance through Jesus Christ. We're going to have an opportunity to say salvation. But here's this. I grew up in a Christian home. I believed in Jesus most of my life. And I still got to come back to the cross and align myself in repentance with Jesus. So if you're here, our response will be of repentance and humility in this moment. So we're going to take this first step of vertical alignment with the Lord as we close. And our response is this. Think about what broken relationship is in need of healing. Think about it for a moment. Let us seek in. And I want to do this a little different than I did first service. Confess where you're wrong before the Lord. We're going to have that time to do that. And then you take responsibility for your piece of the pie. Even if they hurt you, even if if you deem them the one to blame, how can you seek the Lord and say, Lord, how could I have handled this better? How can I take responsibility for my part in this? If you're in a relationship with somebody, you have a part to take ownership of. That's just the truth. So what we're going to do is, there's going to be a prayer on the screen. We'll throw it up there. And we're going to pray this together.
We're going to pray this together. And I know this is in our app, on our sermon notes. If you need to take this throughout this week, sit on this prayerfully. This is going to take time. But this is what we're choosing to do right now in this moment. We're going to pray this through. There's blanks there that you can say their name. You don't got to say it out loud if you don't want to. But in your heart, you know that this is a realignment through a broken relationship that you have with your people, that you're realigning with God first. But your next step is to leave this place when you are ready, when you know God has prompted you to do this, to reconcile that relationship, to begin the process of reconciliation. So let's pray this prayer together. And I'll just repeat after me. Lord, I admit that my broken relationship with blank. So we have to admit, this is my broken relationship. I have sinned against him or her. I want to repent of all those sins right now. I confess my sin of blank. We got to take ownership of something. God, if God's pressing you right now, take ownership of the sin that you know that you need to commit and confess before him right now. I fully commit I was wrong when I blank. Whatever that did, whatever you did, take ownership of it. Take responsibility. I take responsibility for blank. Thank you that I can confess all these things to you because of Jesus' death and resurrection. Thank you for your forgiveness through Christ. Not only do I confess these things to you, but I want you to change my heart and my behavior. I don't want to do more damage to this relationship, yet my behavior will not change unless you change my heart and empower me to live differently. Amen. Amen. This is just one first step, and I pray that the prayer can look, this may just be a one way the prayer looks, but I believe that as you're in this broken relationship right now, continue to take those steps towards Jesus, align yourself so that he can lead you to seek reconciliation with that person. The next step for you is to confront, to have the conversation, to be bold enough to pardon, the courageous act of pardoning the other person. I truly believe God is healing, God is mending, God is restoring. As you take your steps towards him, I'm thankful. You cannot control how they respond, but you will and you can control how you respond. Forgiveness is more for me than it is for the other person. And I pray right now that you would have the courage to face what you don't want to face. What you've been running away from your whole life, God is calling you to face right now in this moment to start the process. Start the process. Start the process. Don't hide. Don't hide in the wilderness and cover yourself. You can't cover your shame. Only Christ can cover your shame. Only Christ can cover us. We need the blood of Jesus Christ. The redemptive work that took place on the cross, that's the only thing that will redeem us and push us to make things right with our family members. Lord, I seal this moment, God. I seal this moment and say thank you. Thank you that you are here in the building with us, God. You have led me, not one, not two, not three, but four different outlines to be here, God, because you wanted to heal the family. You wanted us to take next steps to reconcile with our loved ones. May it not stop here, God. May you bring to mind, if we've forgotten, bring to mind the things that we need to deal with. We trust in you, Lord. You are our rock. You are our anchor. And we praise you in advance for what you will do from this moment forward. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Before we close, I just want to address the online service. We're just so thankful that you are here. You are here, part of the service, and I believe God wants to restore your relationships. So wherever you are right now, wherever you're sitting right now, this word was for you. Please connect with us. We'd love to connect with you. We love you so much. Have a great week.
Hey, online church fam. We just want to say thank you for joining us today. Our hope and prayer is that you were blessed during our time of worship and that you were able to receive a word from the Lord during our message. Before we end, we want to give an opportunity to those of you watching online to make Jesus your Lord and Savior, I'm going to say this prayer, and if you could repeat it after me. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today. We confess with our mouth and we believe in our hearts that you died and rose again. Come and be the Lord over my life as I start this journey with you. We pray all this in your precious name. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said that prayer, we would like to hear from you. Please go ahead and contact us through the number below. We hope that you have a good week, and we can't wait to be with you again.